on our stance. We support the attempts leveled out in the motion about generally consolidating world power as a global dominant power. But moreover, we envision a world, and it's very likely to be the case, in which China and the U.S. probably achieve similar levels of power. And in fact, for that mutual economic destruction between the two countries, we need to get a beneficial balance of power in this world. On to the first constructive argument about why you get more world development. I want to first characterize the recent and current geopolitical system. The fact is that the U.S. has been consistently declining in its multilateral engagement. The fact is that Trump, John Bolton, and all the policy advisors within the White House are now shifting their stance to prioritize domestic issues at the expense of international welfare. They're taking more aggressive, unilateral types of action that is devastating for the rest of the world. That's why we see the examples like the U.S. threatening to withdraw from the WTO and making interactions within the WTO incredibly difficult. The fact that they left the Paris Agreement and are pulling out of free trade agreements left and right. The important implications for this in this debate is that on important global issues and priorities, we aren't getting the kind of multilateralism and leadership that we need to solve some of the most critical and existential issues like climate change and economic issues that plague the developing world. We want to talk about why China is very likely to have good incentives and the capacity to deal with that relevant factor and take that place. First of all, I want to characterize why China likely has incredibly good incentives at the point when it is attempting to establish global dominance. The first reason is that even if they're self-interested, we think that's more of a reason for why they're likely to treat other states very well. The fact is, for regional development and for strong allies, they want to be able to please the other countries. And importantly, the fact that they're becoming a global dominant power means they're increasingly more interconnected with other nations, which means that that integration means that their well-being depends on China's well-being, and likewise. So there's very good incentives to treat those countries well. And in fact, because they're integrated within institutions like the WTO already, we're seeing China liberalizing in a way that benefits them and the rest of the countries in the world. So what are kinds of unique benefits and kind of crucial global issues that we're able to solve on our side with China's attempts at global dominant power? First of all, we get crucial economic development. This is hugely important for countries who couldn't otherwise structurally access loans because of their risk, or who would have otherwise faced restrictive strings attached loans from the IMF and a World Bank that do not fit the country's needs and screw them over. China's plans with the Belt and Road Initiative have been absolutely essential in getting the kinds of incredible development we're seeing, like when we see Djibouti and Ethiopia getting a $300 million deal for a water pipeline that provided basic needs within those countries. We're seeing things like China being way more willing than the U.S. to share patents about free tests in HIV meds at the point when they want to obtain allies in its advanced global dominance. The fact that they want these allies proves why they have good incentives to guarantee that those countries in the developing world have long-term economic growth, because their stability also benefits China directly. The second benefit we get is in terms of environmental issues. China has been proven to be the biggest leader in climate change issues because they have been disproportionately country and its leaders have been built around a cult of personality about countering foreign influence and exploitation of its own people. The fact that they're scared of another opium war crisis, they're scared of another foreign nation being able to dictate its politics and what its people do. The CPP and the Chinese Communist Party necessarily need the kind of cult of personality and feeling of power and control to be able to maintain their status in the country. So, even if it's the case that they're asserting global dominance, they feel less of a need to resort to those kinds of aggressive tactics, like bullying regional allies and bullying regional countries, that are necessarily a distraction and a reason to build a national narrative. You don't need those kinds of things when you can see those shiny banners of the BRI, the fact that China's influence is extending outward, that you are a strong country. Because both on one side of this debate, China has an incentive to be strong and dominant. They think it is better at the point when they're actually able to accrue that power, that they don't feel a need to bully those regional allies and cause problems in this debate. But second of all, and most crucially, even if China has those incentives, we think other states have less of an incentive to provoke China at the point when they're a global dominant power.
Point.
They can't be aggressive against those states when you're more integrated. Things like the Asian Economic Union are absolutely crucial in this debate because it's proven to you, even if you have tense relationships between Japan and China, there is no way there's going to be any escalation of conflict at the point where they all are dependent on each other, at the point where China's global dominance means that they're always able to win any fight, so no country wants to be a fight with them. That applies not only for smaller growth states like North Korea and Japan, but also states like the U.S., at the point where they're balanced in power and economic and military and soft and hard power, why you're far less likely to get that kind of conflict. That alone is essential in this debate because we've proven to you on opposition's best grounds why you're less likely to get the kind of escalation of conflict that leads to the lives of individuals being lost. So what was proposition uniquely able to prove to you in this debate? China is a unique actor in terms of their scale. Their economy is going to be big on either side of this debate, given the structural reasons of their population size and their dominance in markets. The question is, how can we best use that power to ensure they don't have an incentive to aggravate other countries and they're able to provide the structural benefits to economic issues and environmental issues for the long run? For all those reasons, we're incredibly proud.
Your actions are always limited whenever your motivation is power. Two things in this speech. First, I'm going to be refuting opposition proposition material before building substantial arguments for side opposition, before which a quick note on framing. What does China's current rise look like? Because we don't think that's proposition characteristic enough. We think that it's the aggressive and active roots through social, political, and economic strands, and in an opposition world, we think that China would simply give up this pursuit of unipolarity in global atmosphere. What then is the necessary impediment? We believe that there is a current hegemonic power that exists within the global sphere. This looks like a Western world order. Note, it is not our burden to prove that the West is intrinsically good or a better actor than China. We would probably contest that the West is good anyways. Rather, we would tell you that China's unique grab of power is what makes this threat to the world order so dangerous. In fact, our argument is not that China is inherently bad. Rather, in our world, we like China just fine. The problem is the pursuit of any country to challenge this global order is extremely dangerous, especially when you consider the mechanisms that China is currently using. With that substantial rebuttal of proposition's case, a couple of problems with their argumentation. First of all, their first substantive argument is just a laundry list of good things that China is doing. First of all, they tell you about this idea of multilateralism and then they like name drop Trump and John Bolton. I just think that just because Donald Trump is incompetent, that doesn't mean the only way to solve multilateralism is through China, right? Second, we would tell you the comparative is necessarily better. Multilateralism does have checks and balances. This looks like how Germany, the US, can balance each other out, or Canada and the US even. There are internal checks within the Western global order. The second thing that they tell you is this idea of economic development. This argument is extremely problematic. Why? Because unconditional loans that they give to these countries, whenever they give you the examples of Djibouti and Ethiopia, are extremely harmful. For example, unconditional loans, which is what China offers in the majority of instances, were given to places like Uzbekistan, which literally uphold dictatorships, enabling the suppressing of those individuals. The next thing that they tell you about is the idea of climate change. Note that China's climate change initiatives are not unique to the global rise of power. Note that whenever they tell you that China is still going to be an economic powerhouse on their side of the house, this crucially concedes this argument. Because insofar as China has the finances to do it, then they would still be able to do those things like climate change. That's the warrant that they give you. Their second substantive argument talks to you about how the CCP needs to maintain control to not bully other countries in their world as one with co-dominant powers of the US and China. I have a question for side proposition. How exactly do you think that global dominance works? In order to retain more power, China has to do things like try to get other nations under its pocket, especially whenever they tell you that US and China are co-dominant actors, meaning this will never be the end goal of China. Why is this the case? Because China views the Western global order as a threat to its very existence. At that level, we think that it's extremely unlikely that this is going to happen. But I'll talk more about that in substantive. Speaking of, our first substantive argument is about the economy. China is being extremely harmful to the global economy through two distinct mechanisms. First of all, they are attempting to change the global paradigm by not playing by the rules. Let's characterize the status quo. The status quo is one of a yes, Western world order where neoliberal laws are becoming the norm. Note that we already told you that we don't have to defend whether or not it's just that the system is in place, rather that insofar as it is the system that is currently in place, China's threatening to it is necessarily harmful. Why is this the case? It does a few things. First, it violates the rules of this global trade. It does things like currency manipulation. Whenever they talk to you about patents, the problem is that the Chinese corporations are stealing patents and doing things that are threatening to this order. But why is this so problematic? Because it harms free trade and the market. Because other countries can't access economic benefits if China superficially and artificially manipulates the market so they cannot access it. The second way that China is so detrimental through their attempt to seek the rise of power is through the desire for dominance. The West has powerful allies within one another, like the US and Canada, for example, so it knows that it has to play the numbers game whenever it comes to doing these things. It also knows that the perception of China to the West is not very good. This is a unique incentive for China in its global rise of power to get as many countries under its belt through economic manipulation. This clashes directly with their first substantive argument and how they just assume that China is going to treat other states well. What does this look like? It looks like debt traps launched through the One Belt, One Road initiative, where places like Djibouti, Pakistan, and Indonesia lost ports in their countries to China because they could not pay back their debts. It looks like other places like Egypt. Note this crucially means it destroys future stability for these countries because they are unable to determine how they want to do things whenever they're launched into debt with China. Second, this engages with proposition's best case scenario. Even if some of these countries are economically productive, it is not beneficial for individuals within their country. Why is this the case? Because the economic productivity that China launches is through Chinese nationals, so they don't let the native workers work on the good job that they see, only do things like hard labor. For example, in Zimbabwe, you were only allowed to work in the copper mines on the Chinese plant, and you weren't even given a helmet until after 2 years of your service. With that being said, we're going to move on to the second substantive argument before we tell you your point.
Would you rather have China refrain from giving loans to some dictators and leaving ports that were automatically built under your side of the house in a more secure position versus millions of people being fed under our side of the house?
First of all, I do not think that that is the true comparative. Whenever you give China money through those dictatorships, it's extremely harmful. Why? Because that money doesn't necessarily get to the people. Second of all, we think that the alternative isn't that these countries never get any sort of aid whatsoever. We think that there are all things like conditional loans on side opposition that could do things like feed those people. Third, and finally, whenever you tell us about building ports that would never be built, that's crazy. The fact of the matter is that those people that would benefit from those ports on our side of the house don't have access to them. So it literally makes places like Pakistan and Indonesia just ports for China to go through, and they own them and they control those countries. We think this is extremely harmful, specifically linked to the rise of power. On to our second substantive argument about the political and social ramifications of China's rise of power. This argument shows you uniquely why China's global rise will never be checked. Note, this is why the proposition's POI answer we get was completely insufficient, because we would tell you three reasons. First of all, individuals in China are structurally unable to protest against the state. This directly answers their second substantive argument. Because the external of the government of China. They want barriers, they want the barriers that exist to China's rise to be eliminated. So they do things like limit the ability for individuals to do things like protest. Second of all, internally, to rise to the race in China, you need fealty and meritocracy. The people want careers, they cannot challenge the state. The second problem is internally within the government, you don't get these things. Because Xi Jinping made himself president for life. Even if there were checks, even if people wanted to, they could not check his power. The third thing is internationally. Proposition gives us this link. As long as the West does not view China as a threat to their existence, they don't want to pick small fights. Why is this so bad? Because it creates the subjugation of the East. Internally, you see the minority groups of the Uyghurs, a large Muslim population. Xi Jinping views them as threatening the hegemony of China through global dominance. So he views it as justification to subjugate them and throw them in concentration camps. Additionally, externally, you see China collecting colonies in places like Tibet and Taiwan in the South China Sea, using their hegemony to enable the abuse of states within the Southeast Asia. Note, all of our arguments are unique to China's consolidation and rise to power. It is extremely detrimental of citizens of all of the other countries in the world whenever China pursues this global rise. Incredibly proud to oppose.
I want to clarify what this debate is about. This debate is not about whether or not China should exist as a non-democratic country. This debate is about whether the measures taken by China since about 2013 or 2014, when Xi Jinping began to consolidate his power, are overall good for the world. Therefore, all the things the USA tells you in the last 2 minutes of their speech about how China is undemocratic, about how they consolidate their power, and about how they oppress minorities in their country, have zero to do with this motion, which is about what steps China is taking internationally to consolidate its power. We told you from the very start of this debate that on both sides of the house, China is going to be a big country with a lot of people and a non-democratic government. That was never contentious in this debate, but Team USA decided to make it, so let's engage on their terms. Okay, two questions I want to ask in this speech presentation. First, which side is better for the economy of the global world and the global institutions? Second, how does it affect the incentives of the US and other countries? Let's first talk about international. I want to first deal with the characterization of multilateralism that we get out of USA, which is absolutely ridiculous. The claim that we get is what? The USA, Germany, Canada, they all keep each other in check. They have fundamentally different ideologies, and they ensure, no thank you, that the US is accountable. The reality is that the US is pretty powerful. Maybe not debating, but certainly on a global stage. I'm kidding, don't worry about it. The US has a ton of power. Canada and Germany have zero ability to tell John Bolton what to do. They have zero ability to tell Donald Trump what to do at a particular international conference. If Team USA wants to prove that, they're going to have to do a lot more legwork beyond asserting that, no thank you. Okay, so a number of other things. Multilateralism is something that we characterized you first. We said that the only way you can have true competition between international institutions is to have divergent ideologies, is to have things like the Asian Infrastructure Bank, which China develops, and the IMF, existing independently. Team USA responds to this like this. We're not going to defend the neoliberal international order. We just need to prove that disrupting it is bad. Then, their first spends a bunch of time telling us why conditional loans are really good for development. We can go on and on about why the IMF has been very, very poor for a ton of African nations and a ton of Asian nations. But the reality is, what all have to prove to you and failed to do is that the Chinese solutions of unconditional loans are bad. Here's what they say. They'll seize your ports. We have a number of responses. First, those ports would not have existed if China had not built them. This is really important. Second, they say, we're not sure if it's going to get to the people. That's all they said. We explained to you structurally that in Uzbekistan, for example, what was built was a dam. How does the government choose to control a dam and deny the benefits of electricity to its people? We said that the development of trade links literally must trickle down to people because they're inter-business links. to happen between Chinese state-owned companies and between companies in those states. Team USA only asserts a response to that argument. And then they say, look, China sees global order as a harm to its existence. They cannot possibly tolerate the West. I want to tell you a number of things on this. First of all, no thank you. As long as it is beneficial to China to tolerate international institutions like the UN, like the WTO, they're going to want that. For example, China likes WTO because they helped it police and de-escalate the mini-trade war with the United States. Therefore, as long as it is China's direct incentive to keep these institutions, it will. We suggest to you, given the structural reasons that we give, that will be for a long time.
Yeah. How do you think current powers would react if China starts becoming the unipolar hegemon?
I think they would react by trying to constrain it, but that's not really the question in this round. The question in this round is whether or not that is likely. And Team USA has told you that China's really big, it has a big military. None of this has changed since the 1990s, right? If they thought escalation was likely, that would have happened a long time ago. This is because, and I want to make this very important to debate, China is not the Soviet Union. The fear-mongering that they're trying to give you on the side opposition is that we have a rogue state with powerful economies rising. But the reason why you had a bipolar world with the Soviet Union and the U.S. that was so horrible and resulted in so much escalation is because there was zero economic links between those countries. The Soviet Union did not trade with the U.S. and the U.S. did not trade with the Soviet Union. China is incredibly linked to the United States. It is incredibly linked to all global economies. And therefore, if you believe all characterization that all China wants is dominance, and you agree with their characterization that they want to seize your ports, the conclusion that we get is that economic dominance is what China wants. If that's the best they can do, then working with these existing institutions, complementing them, and presenting a viable alternative to the USA is what we're going to do with China. Second question, then, briefly, about the US and other countries. What they say is that there are a number of problems with China, that they stifle protesters, that there's a number of problems with democracy. We say to you that this has nothing to do with devotion, and I flagged that in my introduction, that on both sides of the house, that is going to continue, whether or not we marginally decrease the amount of power that China has over the countries. If we suddenly snap our fingers and say, now China can't give loans to Uzbekistan, they're still going to be locking on Muslims in internment camps. All does not solve for that point because it's unrelated to this motion. If the claim is more generally that China is a bad country and therefore it should not have power, this is again very uncomparative because on both sides it is going to be a big and bad country. This was a debate about what kind of policies it should use to aid the global order, and we suggested to you that those were the policies that we brought to you from Trump. I want to bring a third argument in that's quite important, about why we're able to reverse the USA and Team USA's isolationist path in this round, in the sense that the US does not want to respond to international institutions and Team USA did not want to respond to our arguments. So, third argument about why we reverse USA's isolationist path. What is happening in the status quo? Since the election of Donald Trump, various populist forces in the US have meant that the US has been incentivized towards isolationism globally. What does this look like? It looks like becoming complacent. And the reason why is that ever since the 1990s, when the U.S. declared that history was over, that the Soviet Union had failed, and therefore that internet institutions like the World Bank and the IMF were reigning supreme, there's been a significant amount of complacency in the U.S. as the hegemonic head of this global order. This has meant failed intervention. This has meant money being allocated to the IMF and the World Bank that never gets to the people because there are so many terms and conditions that you actually get default to countries as opposed to the seizure of ports. I want to note also here that when they use the example of like seizing your ports or seizing your dam, that was a solution that was negotiated between Uzbekistan and China for the express reason that would minimize the economic damage, because the alternative to seizing a port was the entire default of that country on loans that the IMF had previously given to them. That solution actually averted the economic collapse of that country. That's something that China was able to offer. So, what do we think happens in the status quo? It is true that we've seen distractions, like the quasi-trade war between the US and China, which has presently de-escalated. Why? Because China and the US were both willing to work within the WTO, for example. The US said, yeah, we'll leave the WTO. We recognize this is an isolationist path. But the reality is, because of the incentives of both of these actors, we got into a place of relative stability. What occurs then? China and the US are heavily interreliant in this world. Chinese companies are listed on the New York Stock Exchange. The integration of these companies in global shipping, the integration of oil companies in global business, no thank you, mean that there's a necessary reliance on each other. What happens when China begins to extend global dominance? The US is forced to take action. US-backed institutions like the IMF and the World Bank are forced to respond. And unlike what Team USA has told you, they actually are doing this. Recently, the IMF reversed its policy of not allowing for massive restructuring of Argentinian debt, directly in response to the fact that there was shipping that a significant Chinese business in Buenos Aires because of shipping that's coming from China. Directly because China could have offered them a better deal, better benefits to their country. Therefore, the US is forced into genuine multilateralism on our side of the house. This is incredibly important in terms of proving that the US responds very effectively to these incentives. Okay, here's what I want to do at the end of this speech. I want to point out that first prompt did not respond to a significant amount of benefits that first prompt gives to you. That if we can prove to you that China is structurally incentivized to behave on climate change much more than the U.S. ever would, the fact that the U.S. has pulled out of the Paris Agreement while China is fighting smog takes over its cities, we win the debate in terms of proving that China's influence in cutting down climate change, if that's going to be the way that it gains global power, is massively important. That the way it can offer economic power to countries is critically important, and that as a global actor, becoming dominant is the best thing you can do in large mass undemocratic people. We are so proud of your votes. Proposition has lacked a little bit of consistency when the first words out of Proposition 1 are that China is going to be an economic power on either side of the house, yet on their third substantive argument, their mechanism is about economic power through companies, which is what they say exists on both sides of the house. In my speech, a few things. First, I'll refute directly their third substantive argument before moving into the two nexus questions to evaluate this draft. First, what's better in terms of economics globally, and secondly, what's better in terms of security, before moving into our third substantive argument on military clashes with the West. Going on to the third substantive argument, we have two more responses besides what I gave you in my intro. First, if it's true that the West is so malicious and so bad, we think it's worse when you challenge their hegemony, because they're not just going to go down swinging. Think about when the West has been the most exploited. It's when they've been challenged. We think they are far less exploited when they are guaranteed hegemony. Secondly, we still don't understand why other actors can't do this. Why can't Japan or Canada yourselves or Germany challenge the United States? Then the question becomes, first question, is what is better for these countries economically? Broadly, they give you a few benefits under the guise of global investment. First, they say China's self-interested, so they create better alliances. We don't think they create better alliances, they just create more alliances, most of which they do, which they exploit to a point where they are unwilling to check their power. Then they tell you, oh, well, the United States is super isolationist and pulling out of the WTO. Few things here. First, let's look at the comparative. The United States is threatening to pull out of the WTO, but China actively ignores the rules of the WTO. Things like currency manipulation, things like actively ignoring IP rights. Why is this? It's all of Un's analysis where she tells you that in order to rise, China believes they have to combat the global neoliberal economic order. And the only way to do this is to change the paradigm and break the rules. But secondly, the reason the United States is threatening to pull out of the WTO is because China ignores the rules, again feeding Un's analysis. The next benefit they give you is like One Belt, One Road Initiative, this $300 million deal of a water pipeline. That's the most charitable example possible. It looks more like Sri Lanka, where the Harambota port was taken away for 99 years, notably a port that already existed. But more onto their specific example, we have two responses. First, Djibouti then created a military base because China told them they had to in exchange for decreasing interest, which increased tensions with the West because it's their first advanced military base. Secondly, when that $300 million is rapidly increasing interest, now they exist in China's pocket because they're saddled with debt. Then on climate, we think they still have the incentive to get rid of things like smog in Beijing. But moreover, you don't need islands in the South China Sea to lead the way on climate change. Like, we think plenty of Scandinavian countries are leading the way, but they aren't global hegemons. Then they say, oh, well, it allows you to control rogue states. No, we actually told you they're far more likely to support malicious actors in rogue states. Why? Because they can take whatever they can get to increase their power. This whips on second substantive argument. For example, this looks like supporting Uzbekistan, which literally has a cotton slave trade
propped up by a malicious dictator. At that point, we think, if anything, China's rise to power necessitates that they go to countries which are malicious and don't have other alliances. What did we give you under this argument? Stuff about political and social problems. What was the response to all of Hunt's analysis? That China will always be undemocratic. We said that was remarkably unresponsive. Why? It ignores her analysis, where she said the reason that people don't have the right to protest is because the Chinese government thinks that is a hindrance to their rise to power. The reason that politicians don't have internal checks on Xi Jinping is because they think that is a challenge to their rise to power, because of the fact that they have fealty within the political system. But moreover, Proposition 2 makes a devastating error where they tell you that economically mutually assured destruction always occurs. If that is true, take them on their highest ground, no military conflict ever happens. At that point, there's never any international intervention for China's malfeasance. That's why the Uyghurs will never get liberation. That's why people are forcibly moved by the millions to make room for dams in urban centers, because international actors will never fight back, all unique to China's rise. The second question is then, what is better for global security? We don't believe their characterization about who you don't bully actors, because we're talking about Tibet competing for the Philippines' scrappy islands and literally fighting ASEAN, a regional economic group, again, with the UN's first substantive argument. They do this because they want power. What was our comparable material on economics, about how, and on political security? They basically say that the AIIB is good and multilateralism is good. This argument assumes that the end goal is power sharing. We think the reality is the end goal is they want the AIIB to be the one and only multilateral institution, in which case it turns their third substantive argument. Moreover, they said these ports wouldn't have existed otherwise. But in cases where they gave a loan and don't build anything, the response is taking collateral of existing infrastructure. Moreover, we told you the long term is always worst. Lastly, they drop a crucial argument about how subjugation always exists. If it's true that China is a benevolent economic actor, why then did UN's analysis go unresponded to about how they import their own workers, undercutting markets? Why then is it true that coal miners in Zimbabwe work for 2 years before they get a helmet? The reason being, China doesn't care about these other countries, they care about their own power. Our third substantive argument directly clashes with most of their material. Before I get into it, I'll take a POI.
So if the reason why China suppresses dissent and blocks up Muslims is its desire for global power, why has it been undemocratic since the years of Mao?
Because the years of Mao was the beginning of their desire for a rise to global power. Our third substantive argument is on how China's rise necessarily causes a clash with the West. What is the status quo? The West is the hegemon. We don't have to defend this, but it is the reality. China's rise necessarily antagonizes the West and escalates the likelihood of military conflict. Max in Proposition 2 literally concedes this in a POI. So let's analyze China and the West's incentive structures. First, China views their rise as a zero-sum game. This is true because they internally believe they can't win another way. Because they are so fundamentally different than the existing ruling status quo, they think it has to win outright and they can't share the power. Crucially, knocking down Proposition 1's framing, meaning they see the ways the West has historically responded to competition and thinks the same will happen. Secondly, what are the West's incentives? The West feels threatened, what Max tells you, meaning they're not going to risk allowing China to gain any power. Note this doesn't clash with UN's second argument, because the West unlikely will have offensively challenge China, will always defensively contend them. This creates a spectrum of increasing harms, of increasing the likelihood of conflict. At best, this looks like Djibouti's forward military base, the first one in North Africa or the Middle East. Even worse, it looks like their military buildup in the South China Sea and actively antagonizing the United States. Or most catastrophically, it looks like supporting a nuclearizing North Korea with a crazy man in office as a proxy in order to combat Western hegemony in South Korea. Strategically, this argument is very important for the round, because even if Proposition wins that their world of sole Chinese hegemony or their world of shared power is good, we say the prerequisite to getting to that world is always war. Meaning, even if you buy their benefits, they can never be outweighed by the war that is necessarily caused, because the West will be unwilling to give up that power without a fight. I'm proud to oppose.
Thank you. second opposition speaker, and I would like to invite the third opposition speaker.
Thank you. So, the point there would be a substantially worse
they said that's good because dictators aren't going to use money responsibly, but China has oversight procedures to guarantee this kind of infrastructure is actually being built. They want it to be built because when it is, once again, that is good for China because our new allies are now substantially stronger and they are now far better off. So even if you buy their farms at some greater debt, that has very little impact on the life of the average person. We were able to do that substantially more people while the attack is like basic infrastructure and we prepared that they were not able to win. Secondly, though, even if you do not buy our claim of economics, we have built your substantially better for the environment because only when China's global power are they able to attack these kinds of issues. But when China has massive amounts of smog, means that they have the greatest global incentive to invest in these kinds of policies. They try to say that China will try to do this under either side of the house. We agree to have an incentive under either side of the house, but our claim was they only have the capacity to invest in these kinds of things when they are a global power. They're thinking, firstly, because they have increased soft power, where they're able to do things like inner development projects, guarantee that the eco-friendly tech is actually being used. But secondly, they have massively more amounts of capital under our side of the house to invest in this kind of technology, because we think that the BRI is mutually beneficial. China's that big, so their economy is large under the status quo. It's larger under our side of the house, as you can second. Increases your scope to invest in green tech. So crucially, we are able to lead off a massive global climate crisis. It's not only about China, but the guaranteeing that like coastal villages not going to be flooded, preserving local autonomy. Go for it.
How does the crazy John Bolton and Donald Trump you characterize on your side of the house react whenever China begins to gain immense political power?
Yeah, so I think that firstly, your case also relies on the premise that it's only a temporary shift in the US. But secondly, I think that even irresponsible people in the US government do have some kind of checks and balances, so whether they're not going to do irresponsible things. Like, yes, China, Trump rather tries to implement a trade war, but he was restrained by people in his cabinet, which is why things have massively doubled down under our side of the fence. On the final question, then, I'm looking at China's likely to respond. They tried to say that China is likely to back down on people and lock them up. We explained that that was not inherent to China's bias, and they tried to save this in seconds by saying that no, China is locking people up because they think it is an impediment to their global power. A couple things to say there. Firstly, as they flagged their appeal lines, China did this even when they were incredibly isolationist during the good times of now. Clearly, there is no correlation between being a global power. But secondly, even if I look at the Chinese government right now, I think it's fairly clear that they want to do this because they benefit from things like more money and being in control of SMEs. They're not going to just stop clamping down on protesters if they weren't trying to rise to become a global power. What we were able to prove about China is that when they are a global power, they're actually likely to be far, far less aggressive. Firstly, this was due to the fact they become more economically interconnected with other states, a pivot to mentioning first. The one who are tied to other states, we're not going to be likely to do things like wage a massive war, because that is going to do things like send your own currency tumbling. But secondly, we no longer have to do things to prop up your own domestic political narrative, because you have that kind of legitimacy under our side of the house. So not only are we able to lead off a massive, massive conflict, because China is a lot more secure, but finally they're compared to cracking down on Uyghurs, but it's actually less likely to happen under our side of the house, because you have a way for your dominance to be certain in other ways, which not mean this. For all these reasons, I'm very proud to say the proposition.
Thank you for that, by the way, are able to check them and
assert peaceful economic interdependence. But if Proposition said China's goals were to stop the United States and stop other Western powers from doing the things that they're doing in a lot of places, what other result could you possibly think would happen besides war? That is why the first theme I'm going to be touching on is this comparative and this argument that we've made. Note that this is the highest layer of the debate because all of their benefits, such as climate infrastructure and economic infrastructure, occur if China wins the race for global dominance power once it gets global dominance in the first place. But the intrinsic harm that I'm going to bring to you under this speech occurs during the process of getting there and destabilizes the process of becoming a global dominant power in the first place. What is the first argument underneath this? Western backlash. This was our third substantive argument, which is the crowd responded to by a bunch of things, like China's able to check the West with some incentives analysis. But we thank the proposition for the characterization that they gave us in their first speech, that John Bolton and Donald Trump are currently members of the United States federal government, that those things are likely to create a more belligerent stance, and a large amount of history has proved that China and the United States are necessarily in a zero-sum game. That means if the economy, just like China being an economic power, exists on both sides of the house, like China's companies, the United States doesn't view that as a military threat. But when China attempts to expand military power through that you see increased military spending in the last part of the parentheses over there, and tries to expand into like the South China Sea, tries to take land from people, attempts to ignore global rulings like a bunch of game about its land expansions, and ignores territorial boundaries, again, a part of their rise for global dominance power, that is what causes the West to view it as a military threat. That is the unique distinction between the mechanisms that we're presenting to you on our side of the house and the mechanisms that they're presenting to you on their side of the house, because they're befuddling the characterizations between like economic interconnectedness and what China would actually end up doing if it attempted to become a global dominant power. This looks like its attempt to like seize Tibet and make sure no one else ever said anything about it, and bullying other countries into like not accepting the Dalai Lama, things like that. That proves that China's end goal is something that is military related that would result in violence. Their third proposition speaker says, if we increase economic integration, which means like China, because China has a lot of the United States debt, and that there's like global trade interconnectedness. The status quo proves that the United States is willing to react this way because Trump started the trade war with China because China was doing things like influencing currency and ignoring the rules of the World Trade Organization and the rules of liberalization. That proves that this backlash and this necessary power is necessary. But what is the impact and the implication of this? It means every benefit that they try to bring you on their side of the house is necessarily never reached because Western powers react so negatively and because they attempt to actively compete against it. For example, they give you the example of increasing investment in places like Africa. But what's happening there is that when China goes to one country, the United States and other Western powers go to like the next door neighbor and aggressively lobby to that next door neighbor. When two countries are aggressively lobbying to interconnected countries that are right next to each other, we called that a proxy war during the Cold War. You can call it something else now if you want to, but the result would still be the same, which is that the long-term result is two actors attempting to fight for hegemony in the middle. This is actually backed up by the characterization that they give you, that on their side of the house, eventually the US gets some economic power, and China gets some economic power, and they meet in the middle and 50-50 power of the world. This is a horrible thing, because the mechanisms by which they say they de-escalate China is like China feels secure. Remember when they tell you that China would stop like trying to be so nationalistic and create a cult of personality if it got lots of security. But if China has like the other part of the world be the United States, then they're never going to stop that incentive and be significantly worse on their side of the house because China would feel uniquely insecure, which is the mechanism that they bring. They say that China's expanding, not going to expand on the SES on their side of the house. That's ludicrous. China's expanding dominance power is why they're expanding in the SES, why they're building nuclear islands and that stuff. So, in this debate, there have been a lot of like examples thrown around and things that you might find, like individual examples in different places. But remember the mechanisms by which I presented to you. The characterization of the incentives of the United States, the characterization of the incentives of China, and by what unique mechanisms this like checking that occurs on their side of the house would actually occur. That means that this opposition has definitively won this punch. The second clash of this debate is about the intrinsic benefits of China being a global dominant power. I want to first talk about the economic benefits. First, China's economic structures and incentives here are basically based on fealty. The reason that they're being so nice to these countries in the status quo is because they want these countries to be part of Team China. If that's the case, then eventually what they're, I'll take you in a second, if that's the case, what they're eventually going to do is want them to not respond to any action that they take. Before I explain that argument a bit further, I'll take your point.
Even if you're massively new characterization about not as highly unlikely because of the soft power that China is using rather than aggression and the economic information that it characterizes. Why is that more important than a high kick for warning the South China Sea and the Arctic
So diplomacy and economic integration due to mechanisms like trade, you told us exist on both sides of the house. The argument opposition is presenting is that when China tries to gain global dominant power by ignoring the rules of the trade organization and military expanding, it creates the incentives for the actors that are currently checked by regular trade and regular economic benefits to then shift to military action because China is shifting to military action. That's been our argument from the beginning. Now, the argument I was explaining on the economic sense was actually kind of good because there were some mechanisms that we presented to you in our first substantive argument, in our first speech, that just sort of got laughed at by proposition, but actually do matter. Like the fact that the people inside China cannot intrinsically check what actions it's taking. If that's the case, and China then becomes a part of a global economic situation in which there's mutually assured destruction, and no one's willing to check it on the international sphere, what mechanisms are there left to check China? If there are no external mechanisms to check, because no one's willing to engage with it, because it's a global power, and there are no internal mechanisms because of the characterization we presented to you, that's what makes it more likely that China is able to engage in abusive actions. That moves the economic benefits. Other than that, we've engaged in a lot of analysis here, so I don't want to deal with all the complicated examples, but I will say that the reason China is putting countries in debt is because its eventual goal is dominance over those countries, because it wants to expand its list of political allies. That's what we told you in our first speech, that it needs to play the numbers game, which means you should filter this through the incentives that we've given you from the beginning. The last touch on climate, I want to point out that their first mechanism for this was that China cares because there's smog in its own cities. Its global dominance power has nothing to do with it caring because there's smog in its own cities, which means it's likely to have the incentive to engage in climate change reform anyway, especially because climate change is going to kill us all. I'm kind of sad about that. But the real point is that every country will eventually have an incentive to engage in climate reform. But what they do is increase military power in a way that uniquely invites military clashes back.
We give you two reasons as to why this isn't true. First, China sees it as a zero-sum game because the two systems are so fundamentally different. And secondly, the West is unwilling to budge and lose their unipolarity. They are so ideologically opposed that neither country wants to compromise. If the Cold War tells us anything, it's that the West isn't going to give up without swinging. Their best argument behind this was about economic interconnectedness. But I think we sufficiently proved the status quo proves this is false. At the point in which Trump has put 25% tariffs on $400 billion worth of goods, I'm not willing to risk and hedge our bets that a war between the West and China doesn't happen at the point their relationship is becoming more tense. Rather, the best characterization is that China is always seen as a military threat, so the West never voluntarily gives up their hegemony. All of their arguments are as to why Western unipolarity is bad because there are no checks on them. But they never answered what checks exist on their side of the house when China becomes the unipolar hegemon, at which point it comes down to weighing. We think the West, at the very least, has democratic structures to in order to check each other internally. That doesn't exist on their side of the house. But even if this is unlikely, the risk of war is so great that you should not risk it. And if you buy all their analysis that their world is good, we say the path to getting to that world is so devastating that we wouldn't risk it. But before that end result, is China's fight for hegemony even uniquely good? This takes up on their highest ground when you buy their analysis that the economic interconnectedness means these countries will never fight. They said it allows China to provide investment to other countries. But we told you that investment is maliciously given. No, debt is non-unique on both sides of the house, Proposition 3. The reason they saddle countries with debt is because in response, it tethers that recipient country to them politically. How do you think they got a military base in Djibouti in the first place? Because they saddled them with debt. The question still stands. If China is so benevolent, why then do they flood the markets with cheap goods using these brand new ports? Why then do they not hire local workers? Why then, if they do hire local workers, do they refuse to give them basic labor standards? The reason being is because they want to extract value and extract political alliances. Rather, what they do is they prop up malicious actors. We told you they want power for power's sake. This looks like both Uzbekistan and North Korea. And we told you, even if there's an existing malicious actor, they actively create a more corrupt regime because that insulation feeds into their political tethering to Chinese power. But lastly, we said, international actors are unwilling to check anything. Take them on their very highest ground. No degree of conflict ever happens. That's the problem, because that allows China to insulate itself to do things like put Uyghurs in concentration camps, and the West is too afraid to unrespond. It allows them to do things like move millions of people forcibly, and the West is unable to respond. We think at that point, their characterization on their very highest ground, at best, feeds on the analysis that was carried down the bench. Proud to oppose.
Better development for the developing world gets to solving the most crucial existential crisis in our history. the junior vote.